Hey, everybody, it's Scott Steen with winnersandwiners.com coming to you with the Monday edition of Today in Sports Betting. As always, I'm joined to take a look at the NBA with my partner. He is the one and only Scott Reichel. Scott, how are you today?
Yeah, doing pretty well. Big win by the Islanders, which definitely helped out my mood after the Yankees continue to be terrible.
Wow.
And after the Nets choked pretty badly against Miami on Sunday, plus Durant's injured again. What else is new? So, yeah, not a great weekend for my teams, but the Islanders picked up a nice win, so it's not the end of the world.
Little OT victory there. Nicely done.
Little OT own goal situation. Islanders had not scored in, like, the last three games, because they went the full 60 minutes against Philly and didn't score before overtime. So, it's not good to have a 60-plus minute goalless streak in the NHL, but they were able to get the win.
How about that defense?
Yep. Actually, it wasn't even 60 minutes. It was an 180-minute goalless streak in the NHL, which is not a fun time.
Well, let's talk a little TV basketball, shall we, Scott?
I wonder what teams are going to be playing. I'm sure it's teams we've never seen play before on TV.
It's back to your old pal, Scott.
I really can't complain, though, because, you know, Golden State, it's spoiler alert, it's the Golden State-Philly game. I feel like Curry is much must-watch television anytime he's on the court, so I'm not going to complain about it too much this time around.
He looked pretty good. Was it Saturday night?
He looked pretty good coming off the bus. Like, he's within range as soon as he comes off the bus. Like, you see people walking down, showing off random fashion. You can just tell Curry's looking at the rim from the garage. I think I can go 8 for 10 from here. He's on a different planet right now.
He had an incredible stat about the number of games that you made over 10 three-pointers.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Curry had more than, like, the next four guys combined.
I'm pretty sure in the last four games or so, Curry has more three-pointers than about 30 teams in the league. Or, like, about, like, 28 teams in the league. Like, it's really just crazy how good he is at shooting. Everyone already knew how good he was, and yet you thought that the peak was probably his MVP years. And yet he somehow found an even greater peak, and yet his team keeps losing anyway. So
I had the Celtics in that game, and that three-pointer that he hit to cut it to two, when I thought
– The one that looked like he was going to hit the ceiling?
I thought it screwed us. Yeah, he's off balance from the corner, just strings. Like, oh, are you kidding me? And, you know – And shame on me, because every time he makes one of those unbelievable shots, I'm like, oh, you got to be kidding. You know, you think – I've seen him do it for 10 years. You think I'd be used to it by now, but –
Well, it's not your fault. You just assume he'd miss one.
Yeah, yeah, just
– But it doesn't happen. Boston ended up covering, but that's also a testament to how we've talked about Golden State and how Curry is by himself out there. And now they face a Philly team, which has played, say, okay lately. I mean, they beat the Nets, who were resting almost everybody. They almost choked that game, but they won. Almost choked against the Clippers. But they won that one as well. Yeah, team's good. Really not much else to say. Philly's the one seed in the East right now. And Golden State, they are a fringe playoff team with one of the best offensive shooting seasons of all time. So, for a player. So, I think that pretty much speaks for itself, doesn't it?
Yeah, it really does. You know, and this is a good Philly team if you're a Philly fan. They've won 11 of their last 15.
For the number, they're not that great.
It's not a great Philly team, though, if you like a team that covers, because in those 13 games, they've covered the number just 5 times. So, or 15 rather, they've covered five. So that's not ideal, Scott. It really isn't. Excuse me, and I lied. I'm lied. Sorry, buddy. I'm a little rusty. They've covered 7 of 15, won 11 of 15.
It's so still four, below
four five. Times they've won and not covered.
How it's about still that? Below 500 in terms of cover.
Yeah, yeah, and they're not a great cover team. Having said that, you can't fade them here, can you? 6 points?
You see 6? FanDuel is 8.
Is that what I saw? Oh, you're right. I was looking at this. My eyes were automatically drawn to the Celtics. Sorry.
You know, PTSD has an effect on some people.
Yeah, I know, right? I can't believe I actually won. I bet on the Celtics and won. That was just
crazy.
Phenomenal victory for me.
I'm sure you broke out the champagne for that one.
It was a mimosas this morning, but
nice
enough. Mm-hmm. Philly -8. For me, Scott, God, I hate to do it. You know, this is a Golden State team that's You know, they've covered four of their last five for, by all rights. They should have covered against Boston. It should have been five straight. I don't love the center matchup. Obviously, you know, every game we play, who's going to stop whoever? And this time who's going to stop Joel Embiid, especially without Wiseman out,
He should go for 40 if he wants to.
You know, we talk about these guys. We talk about Giannis and we talk about Jokic, and like you say, yeah, they should go for infinity, but somehow, sometimes they just don't get it done the way we think. So, is that going to be one of those nights, Scott?
If I really am looking at this number, especially with Tobias Harris being questionable, and they're not sure if he's going to return, I'm going to take the points. I'm not thrilled with it, of course, because Golden State's a team that has wasted many great shooting performances from Curry this season. But he's on another level, and Philly seems to play with their food a little bit. They seem to win games, but they don't exactly do a great job of finishing games out.
Yep.
Or they might be up double digits, about 7 minutes to go. You think you got it in the bag, and the next thing you know, the other team goes on like a 10-0 run, and you're not really sure what Philly's doing out there. Mm. Seems to be what Philly's MO is. They win the games in the end, but I think even 76ers fans can admit that some games get a little bit more dice than they probably should, and it seems like everything kind of spirals out of control for about 2-3 minutes before they get back on track and end up winning the game. Do you think Philly's going to win? Yes. Do you think it's going to be a close game? Yes. So for me, I think Philly wins by about 6. Do I think Tobias Harris is going to play? Pure guess by me, no. I don't think he's going to play, but which I think will cause the line to drop a little bit. But for me, I'm going to take the points with the best shooter on the planet.
Okay.
But again, if Curry goes for less than 35, they're probably screwed. But, you know, come to the territory.
Yeah, we've seen Curry be able to single-handedly keep the games close.
Yep.
So maybe the question we should be asking, instead of who's going to stop Embiid, who's going to stop Curry?
Well, truth is, I don't even know. Because you're looking at Ben Simmons, you're looking at Tybal, and those are going to be the main two options for mm-hmm. Philly because they're great perimeter defenders. But people have been trying to figure out a way to guard Curry for the last week and a half, and it seems like nothing anybody does ever works. So I'm just going to assume that the only way to stop Curry is to just pray that he misses, and so far that hasn't been working too well.
What kind of defense does Philadelphia play, Scott?
Are you talking about a style of defense? Because they kind of rotate between them.
They play elite defense.
Oh, okay.
Everybody's ready to drink, and they didn't even get the drink. Let me ask you, are you concerned about the game back in March? Philadelphia came into Golden State, beat them by 10, covered the 4.5 easily.
Curry didn't play, so no.
So that didn't concern you?
You have to throw it out the window. I mean, one game they played, Embiid didn't play, Curry didn't play, so what's the point?
Isn't that a wash?
I think it's a wash from the perspective of throwing it out the window. I don't think that contributes to anything involving this game. I'm assuming you agree, because the Warriors without Curry, we've seen how they struggle even with Curry, which is painful to watch. Without him, that's just that's a bad team right there. Without him, they're probably a bottom six team in the league.
Yeah, they were next level bad there without Curry in the lineup. So
I feel like every time the Warriors lose when Curry goes for 40+, like watching the Mets waste a start by DeGrom.
Yeah, that's a great analogy. Very, very similar.
But for me, I'll take the points in Golden State.
Huh?
I'll take the points in Golden State.
I'm the same way. Yeah, I'm with you. I think that number should be closer to. I think I had it right, Scott. I think that number should be 6.
I agree.
All right. Late game. It's the. Please be the Lakers. Please be the Lakers. Woohoo! It's the Lakers, Scott.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure that was not staged at all.
Should be a pretty good game. This should be a pretty good contest between Utah and the Lakers. Scott, what's the matter with Utah?
I said a couple weeks ago, I don't think Utah's as good as people think they are, and they haven't played well since. I think it was the Dallas game where I watched them play, and they just came out, and I could tell offensively, this team just doesn't really have any – I'm trying to think of a non-cliche way to put it. They don't have any dogs besides Donovan Mitchell.
Yeah.
He's the only guy that I really trust in a big game situation who I know – can potentially go for 40 and have a big game. Gobert, of course, is a dunk specialist who can set screens and blocks a ton of shots. We already know that. But you're looking at the rest of this team. Conley has not been good lately. Boyan's been good, so I'll give him props there. I know Clarkson was injured. He's back. He played pretty well against the Lakers over the weekend. But I'm just looking at this team, and you're just looking at these lineups, and you're giving decent amount of minutes to Royce O'Neal and company. I'm not exactly thrilled by your prospects. So Utah, the only thing I have to wonder about this matchup, though, is that they played over the weekend, and nobody on Utah played. Gobert didn't play, Conley didn't play, Mitchell didn't play. Of course, Mitchell's still going to be out for this game. But even with all those guys out, Utah still forced it to go to overtime. And now you're probably going to be getting Gobert back. You're probably going to end up getting some of the people that end up missing that game, Conley, for example. So the question is, if they were good enough to end up going to overtime against the Lakers anyway, despite being really shorthanded, are they good enough to cover 5.5 without Donovan Mitchell? Because I think you can agree that Utah sent out, what do you think, a C squad on Saturday?
B plus probably.
I'm going to go C because benching Conley and Gobert is not really a great look for a B squad. But the point is that this roster for this game should be better than the roster for Saturday's game. So do you think Utah's now good enough to cover to win by 6+? I'm still on the fence. But if you wanted to take Utah, I can understand it based on the last game that they played.
Well, we don't know that Gobert's going to play this game.
He's probable, according to ESPN. He's on my fantasy team, and we're in the playoffs, so I've been keeping tabs on Gobert's status.
I've still got him as questionable.
Apparently it was a back thing. I heard he's fine. They were just holding him out. I think you kind of have to play him, don't you? I mean, you're looking at the Clippers and you're looking at the Suns breathing down your neck now. But it looked like an easy one seed now turn into a potential three in the span of about, what, a month and a half?
Yeah. Yeah, they were riding high there with their streak and everything.
It's a great streak. And then ever since then, they've been a pretty mediocre basketball team.
Yeah, to me, and I know they took it to overtime.
I would still take the points with the Lakers. But
I think, yeah, I have to. I just don't trust this Jazz.
I was just throwing that out there for devil's advocate. So I'm saying I can understand if you want to take Utah, but without Mitchell, I got to take the points because I really think that this team just I can't really explain the main issue besides I just don't trust anybody besides Mitchell on this entire team. And I think that with him out, the game's going to come down to Jordan Clarkson. It's really what it's going to come down to, because without Mitchell in the lineup, Clarkson is going to have the greenest of lights. It's going to be greener than Bonds on 3-0. He's going to be shooting as soon as he gets off the bus, and if he starts missing shots, he's not going to stop shooting. And I think you can agree with that. Now, he had a good game over the weekend. If Clarkson struggles, I think Utah's going to lose the game outright, which is my half-bold call, but I think you can agree it makes sense.
Well, this is a Utah team that even before they lost Mitchell,
they were already struggling.
But they weren't playing that good of basketball.
Yeah.
They've lost 4 of their last 8. They failed to cover 6 of their last 8. Mm-hmm. I just don't know how you walk into the middle of that. Yeah, they lost Mitchell on the 16th, but you know, they'd lost three of five going into that game. So
Yeah,
to me, I'm taking the Lakers at the points. And
I got in early on the fading Utah bandwagon from a couple weeks ago, and it seems like that read was pretty solid at this point. I don't want to say that these playoff series last year was a microcosm of their season this year. Doesn't it feel like a lot of the same things that happened when they were up 3-1 against Denver? It looked like it was going really well, looked like they were about to be a secret dark horse candidate, whatever you want to call them, and then everything hit the fan in the span of about a week.
Yep, that's you know, so goes Mitchell, so goes his team. So,
yep.
All right. Anything else on the card get your attention? Not a huge card tonight, but
yeah, I'm gonna have a play today on something. After, by the way, I want to give a quick shout out to one of our loyal viewers of the show, Madison Bumgarner, for kicking my ass yesterday. After we talked trash to him for about, I don't know, a week or so, he killed my play today yesterday. So
yeah,
going back to basketball. But looking at the rest of the card, do you want to take Washington -10.5 against Oklahoma City on a back-to-back? Because Oklahoma City, you know, Utah, it's funny we mentioned Utah because they ended up ending my perfect run with Oklahoma City fading. I haven't touched them since, and Oklahoma City, for the most part, has done a pretty good job covering since, with the exception of the Detroit game, and I don't remember if there's another one in there. But I think they've actually covered a couple of spreads. But it's a back-to-back. I don't know how many people Oklahoma City are actually going to play. And the Wizards, they might not be good, but they're actually playing decently well over the last week or so. Do you think they win this game handily, or do you think that they're just going to mess around and it'll be randomly close?
Well, I've got a premium on this, so
Okay, good talk.
But I will tell you this, Scott. That's a little bit of selective recall because
The Thunder is still awful. If I was going to play it, I'd take the Wizards.
They've covered one of their last nine.
I'm just saying. I remember the one all too well. Well, now it's two because they covered against. Oh wait, they didn't even cover against Toronto today.
No. So one of their last ten.
Toronto in the overnight was 11, and it went down to 6. I forgot that it ended up going down to 6 because Toronto benched everybody. But yeah. Yep. That team stinks, and I don't know if you've wavered yet. I said they weren't going to win a game. You had a shot against Detroit, who was benching half their players, and you had a shot against Toronto, who benched all their players, and they lost both those games. Have you started to reconsider your stance?
Well, no, because it's just still so unlikely.
I'm just saying. I think your best two shots already went right out the door.
No, there's.
Do you think there's one game working in the shadows?
It's the NBA. It's the NBA, man. There's always going to be that weird night. There's always going to be the time where they step up and they just can't get it done.
True. This, if I was going to play the Wizards, I would just take some type of player performance boost thing. Like FanDuel does it, we can take a player prop mixed with the result. Just take Westbrook triple-double and the Wizards to win. I think we can agree after he had a triple-double through three quarters of the last game against New Orleans, he should maybe not against New Orleans, the game – against Orlando, I think he had a triple-double in about three quarters. Westbrook should have a triple-double in this game. I think you'd agree with it. So, if you want the Wizards
to that's a pretty hot take right there.
It's really not, but the point is that if you end up getting both of those together, you can probably get a plus price. So, if you don't overlay the number and you think Westbrook's probably going to do what he normally does, which is, I don't say stat pad, but put up good numbers and they'll win the game, then sure, put the two together and you'll get a nice plus price.
Yeah, that's solid. Yeah, anything you can put together with Westbrook triple double, I think you're ahead of the game.
Yep.
I'm trying to see how many games they have left here.
I know Hachimura is going to be out for that game though for Washington. Yep. So he actually hasn't even been good for the last week or two though, so I don't think it's that big of a deal. But Washington, their centers might not be very good in the sense that they have Robin Lopez and Alex Len, who I don't think are very good, as I just said. But tell you who I don't think is very good either, Moses Brown. And Oklahoma City really doesn't have any centers. So I think that Washington should do a pretty good job on the boards in this game.
Yeah, they've got 15 games left.
Yep.
So, they've got three games against Sacramento.
Sacramento would be the kind of team that would just randomly not show up on one night.
They've got a game against Indy. They've got two games against Indy. And they've got a game against New Orleans. I think those are going to be your possibilities. They've got Golden State. If Curry's hurt, something like that, that's winnable. But, yeah, they've certainly got a way to go. Could they go 0-15 from here? Sure.
They're not going to reach their win total over. That's all I'm going to say.
No, I believe that is true. Yeah. All right, so there you go. All right, guys, as always, if you're looking for more information on these games or any other games, don't forget to stop by and check out winnersandwinders.com, the number one source in the world for predictive sports analysis, deep dives, and predictions on every game every single day. And as always, we wish you guys nothing but the best. I hope every one of those tickets in your pocket turns into cash money back at the window. It's great to be here back with you guys on Monday. Have a great day, and you know what? Just stick around. We'll see you on the baseball side. Thanks for watching us on Today in Sports Betting. Take care, everybody.